Salem, 1692. Kira's legs worked hard to forge her slight body down the narrow, snow-laden deer path that took her from her family's cottage to the nearby village of Salem. She'd managed to slip away from home just as the sun peaked over the horizon. If all went well, she'd be back in her room before the family expected to see her rise, and none would be the wiser. She was determined to meet the ship that was arriving. Not only would the village be abuzz with news of her homeland, but with the recent change in weather, ships would be far and few between after this, at least until the spring. If her package wasn't on the ship, then she doubted she'd see it until the thaw, which would be too late. It was 5 years since her family fled England, after her grandfather died and a vicious land battle between siblings ensued. The Donnelly family was a warring family from its core. Not a day went by when the old man was alive without a fight breaking out between the three brothers. Their sister Colleen kept out of it, for the most part, but there were times when she'd give just as good as the next guy. Angus Donnelly blamed it on a family curse. Perhaps it was. Kira didn't rightly know. All she did know was that she was awoken in the night and shuffled onto a ship to avoid being slaughtered by her father's younger brother, Richard. The weakest of the three, Ned Donnelly, managed to keep his status within the family structure because he was the oldest. According to law, he was to inherit the entire estate and family fortune. His father left a letter asking that Ned see his way to providing land and money enough to each of his siblings to allow them a decent livelihood. Since Ned wasn't a greedy man, and the estate was an affluent one, he fully intended to honor his father's wishes. Unfortunately, his brother Richard, who was next in line should something happen to Ned, was determined to have it all. On more than one occasion over the 3 short months since his father died, he'd plotted against Ned's life. Lady Luck smiled on Ned, and each attempt was thwarted by some strange occurrence. This only made Richard all the more determined. Word reached her parents' ears about Richard hiring a professional assassin to eliminate their entire family just in time for them to escape in the middle of the night with their lives and whatever monies was in the coffer. Fortunately, it was enough to give them a comfortable start in the new land, far from his warring family and the constant threat of death. With the exception of Kira, the Donnelly family took to their new home quickly. Within the year, they were settled on a small estate just south of Salem, where her father farmed and participated in the political dealings of the community. Kira was the only family member who missed her homeland and the lifestyle it provided. Mary Donnelly kept busy with her homemaking, as well as the community sewing circle once a week. Kira's brother, James, became an apprentice at the village print shop. Only Kira seemed unable to take her thoughts off what they were forced to leave behind and embrace what they now had. The only thing that even remotely pleased Kira was the prospect of being married to Jasper Cunningham. Next to the Donnellys, the Cunningham family was the most affluent family in Salem. Kira and Jasper were thrown together often in an attempt by their parents to get them to like each other in hopes of an amiable match. Not that such a liking was needed in an age where families arranged marriages in accordance to status and profit for all parties involved, especially the parents. When her mother confided in her that her father was discussing her marriage to Jasper, Kira's first thoughts were that she would be able to travel back to England and away from the primitive life that was forced on her. It didn't matter that she cared little for Jasper. Marriage to him offered freedom. That was enough. Another bonus in being wed to Jasper was the fact that his family were not diehard Puritans, as were the majority of Salem. Living amongst so many Puritans was the most difficult for Kira, who was forced to cease her practice of herbal remedies for risk of being labeled a witch. That year alone, more than 20 young girls were hanged after being accused of witchcraft, It was scary times in Salem. The thought of being able to freely walk in the woods and collect herbs for medicinal use once she'd returned to her homeland kept her insides excitedly smiling, even if her outside was forced to maintain a calm and pious expression. Her parents didn't know it, but she'd kept private contact with her mother's sister, Margaret, who also lamented over Kira having to live in such primitive conditions. Margaret promised to send cloth and sketches of the most recent styles of society. Kira wanted to make new dresses for herself and her mother in time for the Christmas celebration. It was to be a surprise. She'd expected the cloth to be on the ship that docked several weeks ago, but it came and went with no sign of a package from Aunt Margaret. If she had to wait much longer, she feared she'd have no time to sew both dresses in secret during the hours she'd managed to steal away from curious eyes. Not to mention the fact that she'd have to attend the village Christmas celebration in an old frock that Jasper saw her in more times than she cared to admit. With a potential marriage at stake, she wanted to do all she could to make herself appealing to him. She'd heard a rumor that Isabel Summers' father was also speaking to Jasper's father about marriage. They weren't as wealthy a family, but she happened to know that Jasper found Isabel pleasing to the eye. She couldn't have that wench outshine her. She had to have a new dress for Christmas. The cloth just had to be on that ship. She approached the slippery docks with caution. There was a bad storm 2 days past, and the docks were coated with ice, making footing precarious. The wise thing to do would be for her to wait in the comfort of the dock's caretaker's hut until the goods were unloaded, but she was far too anxious for that. She pulled her cloak tighter and huddled against the bitter cold while doing her best to stay out of the way of the seaworthy men. "Do you wait a letter again?" asked a swarthy sailor as he limped past her. A large trunk burdened his shoulder, causing him to slump so low Kira replied to his tattered hat and greasy hair instead of his face. "Nay," she said with a voice that sounded far more confident than she was. Being amidst a group of men who lacked proper etiquette and were without female companionship for months was something her mother warned her about years ago. She knew the risks, but since Margaret's cloth was a secret, she didn't dare ask her brother to escort her. Had she done so, the entire village would have known her business within an hour. "I seek a package from Lady Margaret Templeton."
"Mayhap you should wait in the keeper's hut," he muttered as he continued walking by. "'Tis no place for a young lass."
"He speaks truth," said a voice that reverberated so deep she could have sworn it came straight from the ocean. "This is no place for a young lady, especially one as lovely as ye are." Kira's nerves practically leapt free of her body from the impact of the energy the stranger emitted. It wasn't the fact that he was tall, well over 6 feet, or the fact that he possessed dark eyes that seemed to look right through her flesh and settle on her soul. It was his energy, plain and simple. She stepped back as he approached. He extended his hand while an offer to escort her safely to the caretaker's hut formed on his thin lips. Instinct told her that she'd be in more danger with him than with all the sailors put together, although she couldn't explain why. "I'm fine, sir, but I thank ye." Her words had no impact as the man continued toward her. Kira frantically surveyed the dock in hopes that someone might come to her rescue, as he reached out and gently took her arm. "I'm fine, truly," she insisted.
"I let the lass stay as she is. I shall be free in a moment to help her with her needs."
Sneered a black-toothed passerby.
My point exactly, the man said with a cocked brow. Her flesh crawled and she shuddered at the sailor's innuendo. She didn't hesitate in relenting to her rescuer's wishes, heaving a sigh as she allowed him to escort her to the hut, all the while craning her head to inspect each laden shoulder that passed them as the sailors and dock workers continued to unload the ship. As he deposited her at the doorstep of the hut, the stranger bowed low, took her gloved fingers in his hand, and said, "Lord Malcolm Jameson, at thy service." Kira curtsied in response. "Kira Donnelly." "A pleasure," he said, with a broad grin and dancing eyes that were so dark they blended with his black coat and hat. "Had I known the New World possessed such beauty, I would have come much sooner." She could feel the heat rising in her cheeks as she lowered her eyes. She hadn't heard such elegant flirting since they left England. Where she took such compliments for granted in her younger years, her 20-year-old ears hadn't heard such elegance in some time. She clung to them like a child to a candy stick. "Ye blush," he said softly as the tips of his long, well-manicured fingers turned her face toward him. His touch felt icy cold, but then it was freezing weather and he wore no gloves. She gasped at his liberties and stepped back. "Ye are too bold, sir." His worldly and seductive eyes bore into her innocent emerald green ones with such potency she felt immobilized. "My sincerest apologies," he finally said as he released his mesmerizing hold on her and bowed low once more. "I know not what possessed me to act in a manner no better than the sailors I strove to protect ye from. Please forgive my foolishness. I shall leave ye now." Her chest tightened with panic as he straightened his tall, lean form and turned to leave. She had no idea why, but she suddenly couldn't bear the thought of being separated from this mysterious, dark stranger. "Please, sir," she said with urgency as she reached for his arm to stop him from leaving. "You were just being kind. I beg you, forgive my rudeness." His face lit up with something that Kira could only equate to the look of a satisfied predator. With silent grace, he offered her his elbow. She took it without hesitation and allowed him to lead her away from the docks. All thoughts of marriage to Jasper or Aunt Margaret's package were abandoned. Her only desire was to remain in this man's company no matter what the cost. They strolled to the edge of the village, not far from the path she'd taken from her father's farm. Her footing faltered at the sight of the path. Fear of being escorted home by him flitted through her before she remembered that he was new in town and would have no idea where she lived. "Might I ask where thee take me?" she said in a sweet, almost trance-like voice after they'd bypassed the path and continued toward a remote and abandoned trapper's hut an easy mile from the village. "Dost thou tire?" he asked. "We shall stop in this little hut, and ye shall rest." "Nay, sir," she said with confidence, "my legs are strong." He murmured in a distracted manner as his eyes combed their surroundings. "We shall stop nonetheless." She obediently allowed him to lead her into the hut, all the while wondering what it was about him that made her throw caution and all her mother's warnings to the wind, like she was doing. The hut was missing a few wallboards, but for the most part, it provided a reprieve from the bitter winds she'd been trekking through since she'd left home at dawn. She surveyed the hut for its contents. There was a wooden table, a stool, a platform bed with a musty straw mattress still on it, a cauldron near the fireplace, and a few tin eating utensils. "I thought this place was abandoned," she said with surprise. "It shows signs of recent use." "'Twill serve our needs," he mused, more to himself than her. "I'm sorry, sir, I do not understand. You say, our needs?" she asked, her nervousness suddenly returning. "Indeed," he said as he removed his coat and waistcoat. Lie down on the mattress.
Pardon?
She practically screeched as she nervously inched toward the door.
Ye are maiden, are ye not?
He asked firmly.
Sir, you should not ask such things, she gasped with clear offense.
Either ye answer, I shall check for myself, he said with a dark scowl. Are ye a maiden? She looked at him with fear and bewilderment and slowly nodded.
"'Tis what I thought. Now please lay down on that bedding,"
he said in a voice so monotone he could have been ordering a dish of stew at the inn.
"I fear you have the wrong girl, sir," she said as she rushed for the door.
The speed in which he was upon her shocked her into submission. Stunned, she gave him minimal resistance when he pulled her to the cot and lowered her onto the musty straw mattress. His eyes bore into hers as he lifted her skirts and adjusted her body into a position that allowed him to fit his slim form between her slender thighs. Her mind shouted for her to resist, to put up some type of fight, but her body felt frozen.
"I am sure 'tis not what you desired for your first time with the man,"